I'm very happy to be here because it's my first FOSDEM, so it's a really nice one. And I also would like to thank Surzi for the whole organization of the dev room. So I will talk about how to build an automatic refactoring and migration tool. But first, who I am. So I'm a software engineer, basically, and I work in a consulting company. And I will talk about that just after. And I'm very passionate about code quality and maintainability issues. And I've been working on such toolkit for 4 years now. So first, in my company, so it's a consulting company, we have a lot of modernization projects in the finance sector. So modernization, why? First, because of technical debt. And also obsolescence. It's not because your design was fine at some point, your technology was trendy 4 years ago, that now it's still the case. So you might end up with project completely not in phase with what you want to build. And also for very old code bases, legacy. So for every code base, at some point, you will need to modernize it. But it's difficult, they are difficult projects. So if we take the financial sector, usually it's a really huge application, more than 1 billion of lines of code. And such projects, because you have a lot of actors, a lot of lines of code, but also a turnover, lack of documentation, lot of different languages, you end up with really costly and long projects. 10 billion at least, usually, and 3-4 years. So it's really hard, and usually it's a real struggle for those companies to modernize their application. And for instance, in production, today we have like 3,000 billion of lines of code running, and just for COBOL, it's 200 billion of line of code running. And COBOL, it's not that new, so it's code that you need to modernize one day. So it's a real real issue, and developers are not equipped enough today, so we have to do something. And on modernization project, so we're starving for automation. So quickly first, because I think if you stayed all day long here, you know code is beautiful data, so I will be quick on the first part. Then I will present you how we transform the code or engine behind. And to finish, I will focus on the refactoring. So first, code has data. So you know, first of all, when you see code, you can relate to text. You have a structure you can relate on. Yes, you have block, you have piece, and the main difference between code and text, it's you have a strong relationship between the entities of code. And what I find the most interesting in code, you have a duality, because the code can be seen as a programmer, so it's text. By reading it, you can understand what it's doing, what is the purpose of it. So here it's a poker game. And after, you have the view as a machine. You don't care about the goal of the program. You just need to execute the instruction. And also, if you you have different languages and you have very strong differences between the languages. So for instance, here, the same example in Java and Python, the goal is just to read a file, but it's 8 lines for Java and just 1 line on Python. So what is the relevant information on that? It will also depend on what is your goal. For instance, in migration, you want to keep all the information. But if you just want to extract the business logic behind, you don't care about all the line. Still on the data cleaning, you can ask this question, what is relevant or not? For instance, generated code, technical frameworks. Is it useful for my use case? Do I need to mine this data or can I forget about it? Also, the comments and the name, they are a very good source of information, but what if the comments are totally obsolete? What if the names are completely wrong? It can be an issue. And you have useful code versus meaningless code. So by that, useful code is the core algorithm of a program, and meaningless code is just the software around to make it work. So it's not a trivial task, and it will really depend on your objective. As always in data mining, you have to really know what you want to achieve to choose what will be the model, what are the interesting data. So cleaning data, processing it. So the global process, you take code, you reverse it, and you have a model. And depending on your use cases, you will have a different model. So I think you have to date with a lot of application on that. So first, you have what I call the formal approach. So it's to the code, it's a structure. You have a grammar because you have a compiler. So you have just one way, one correct way to write things. So thanks to that, we can extract the structure and all the relationship on the code. And the modelization as an IST. It's always good to dig information, and you have a lot of tools existing with this approach, but you can't understand what is the code, what was the intention of the developer behind, and it's really hard to extract the business logic with just this approach. So after, you have the natural approach. So now the code, it's just a simple text, and you can extract the natural language element. But even if you're able to extract the business logic behind, you still have a lot of ambiguities that are hard to resolve. Also, you have an infinite vocabulary. We all know as a developer, we all have different personal convention to name variables. Sometimes for the same word, you can have the shortened version, the long version. So at the end, you have an infinite vocabulary, and especially in the financial sector, but not just this sector, usually you have a lot of application in different languages interacting with each other. So you have to take care of that. And also, sometimes it's not even understandable by a human. So how you make the computer understand? So after, we have the hybrid approach. So it's a bottom-up process. You extract the structure first, and then you consolidate the meaning by understanding the code. So if you understand what a method is doing and what another class is doing, if one is calling the other, you can have a high level of comprehension, of understanding. So we are all here today, so we know that it's still on this field, and you have a lot of application, but we still need to create new algorithms to treat code well. So what we do in my company, it's modernization. So it's refactoring and translation, basically. So based on that, what we wanted to have as a model, it's the most important, it's to have the link between the entities of the code. Because if you want to refactor a method, you need to change everywhere where it's called. An example. So we have a reverse engine. So we start with the pulsing. What is interesting here, it's we have a first step as a scan, because you can have a project file. Like CSproj or Eclipse Proj, and we need to understand that, because in a legacy code base, not all the code is referenced by those projects. So there is no need to analyze and understand the dead code. So it's really important to know what is really used. And we have some I forgot to mention that. Our model, it's a language agnostic. It's because we do a lot of different projects. We have a lot of different languages. So it was really important for us to have a representation for all the different languages, to avoid rewrite all our engines for each languages. And so for that, we have some post-processes to make the code more general. For instance, you may have between languages different paradigms that doesn't exist in another one. So you need to transform it to have a language agnostic model. And after, we have a solving and binding part to retrieve all the interaction within the code base. So here it's an example of an output of our model. So you can see, for instance, here a foo bar. It's you have a reference on it where it's here it's a call, and you have here the link. Also, it was very important to have a query system on our model, because to apply refactoring, first you need to detect what is wrong within the code. You need to be able to quickly go to what you want to transform. So we have a complete query system with analytics tool. So it was really important. So our toolkit. So you have the reverse engine. Today we handle Java, C Sharp, C, C++, COBOL, also VBNet, and all stuff like that. And after, on the model, you have the refactoring engine. So here you have all the transformation on the code. And after, because you need something that compiles, you need to regenerate the code. So you can do it in the same language if you just want to reduce the technical debt, or you can generate it in another language if you need to translate it. It's also interesting here about the language agnostic model. It's thanks to that we are able to transform the COBOL in a modern object-oriented program very easily, because all the complexity was in the reverse engine. So the level of transformation, you need to be able to have a good generated code, is not that high. So here, for instance, an example of code from C++ to C Sharp. For instance, here you have some pointers that have been translated. What is also interesting is if here you have a change of a dependency. For instance, here you have compare no case, and it was translated by two upper compare to. So that kind of things, it was at the beginning, it was just translated by compare no case, like that, but it was not available in C Sharp, so it was not compiling, and we added a rule when you see this method. In fact, in C sharp, you have to translate it into upper compare to chain of calls. So what we do in project, at first you have a lot of, for all the dependency, at first it's not compiling at all and you have a lot of error because of that. So it's a mix of done manually, and when you can add rule like that, you can translate it. And I will focus on the refactoring because but it's very important, the refactoring. You can't do any modernization project without refactoring, and if it's done manually, it's a waste of time, and you had some defects in your code. And this is our first version of Engine, and we were dreaming about a magic refactoring engine with an automatic detector using machine learning to be able to detect all the code smell, what can be done differently, and automatically refactor everything and have a clean code base in the end. But in fact, our clients were not very happy with that because for them it was not possible. They wanted to have a choice of what they wanted to refactor. They wanted to refactor the way they were used to it. So it was not working at all, and we had some failed project because of that. In fact, even if the code was compiling at the end, the client was not happy. So what we learned from that, it was really important to let the client have the control. To have a catalog of refactoring, but the client can personalize them. And also, sometimes some clients, they have very specific needs and it's just specific to the company or the team, so you don't have a generic refactoring for that. So they need to be able to create their own refactoring. And also, no big bang is crucial application. And usually it's 3-4 years, and you can't do it one time. And also because you don't transform the code without unit test, and usually they don't have unit test. So they really need to keep the control and do refactoring class by class and so on. But they still wanted to have the possibility to industrialize something. If they wanted to change, for instance, a dependency, the first time they need to change the dependency, they can create a refactoring for this dependency and then apply it to all the code base. So this is our second version. So you have a detector with a catalog of code smell. Then you have a remediator using refactoring catalog. And from that, you can create a plan of refactoring and then apply it. What is interesting here, it's because of the structure, you can add very different way to detect the code smell in your code. For instance, we can use the input of sonar. We can use we have already some methods and way to detect things. But you can create and have different algorithms. Really, you can add something very specific of your use case. And it's the same for the refactoring. And yes, also it's an iterative process because sometimes when you refactor something, you create other defects. So now we have a loop for that. And it was a shame for us, but when we started this project, it was 6 years ago, we wanted to put machine learning everywhere. But in fact, because of the constraints I said before, it was really hard to implement, and also because of some specificities of the banking sector. First, Each time we had a client project, it was like 3 months, something like that, just to be able to see the code. Lots of DNA to sign. It was really, really hard. Imagine if you have to gather all the code of the company to train a data model. I think it will need at least 3 or 4 years. No revision history access, sometimes because the code is too old, or sometimes because it's just too difficult as an external provider to get this kind of information. So it was not possible to see the evolution of the code base to learn from that. After we thought, okay, but you have a lot of code online, so why can't you use it to learn our model? But in fact, there is a real difference between the code you can find online on GitHub and the code in search industry. You have company patterns that you can't find really easily, and at the end you will end up with a bias. Also, because we are in modernization project, you have to imagine there are the worst code base that you can see. The legacy is really really huge, you really have to change everything. So you have nothing within the code base that you want to keep like this. This kind of project, you have always to change the architecture, and you can't do that automatically. So you have to always mix the both aspects, and especially on legacy code, nobody agrees on what is good, what it is to keep. So in fact, it's really hard to train a model on that. So that's why we implemented first a lot of algorithm and heuristic not using machine learning because of this constraint. But now, because we have we have an engine like this with all the different modules, very separate. It's now possible for some small use case use machine learning. And today, it's our current state. So we created this, so our client could be happy, because we do a lot of projects and they are successful. But now we want to go further, and I hope to see in a few years a lot of different engines using machine learning. So in conclusion, if you want to start with the sector, don't start with financial ones. For me, it's really the beginning of a new era for the developer, and to give the developers the tools to be able to modernize, change the code without the big pain it is today. And that's it for me. I had a demo, but I have not enough time to do it. But if you're interested, 5 minutes? Okay. We can do it quickly. So it's a video because I don't want the demo to crash. So it's open source code. It's an example. It was made for non-technical people, so it's really the code is not that complicated. So here it's in this. I want to scroll, but no, it's a video. It's really disturbing. So here, for instance, you have an access to a database. And you have an hard-coded string here. It's a user account. And you have an underscore here. And everywhere in the file, you can see there is no underscore. So imagine in the process of everyday process, my tech lead tells me you have to change the user account's name and replace it with uppercase for the A letter. So it's easy, in just a few seconds. But in fact, this hard-coded string, it's a different emplacement. Location, sorry, within the file, and it's duplicated 5 times. And if I look deeper, I can see you have other hard-coded strings. Even if they are good, they are still hard-coded. And do you know manually how much time it will take to extract a variable for each hard-coded string? According to Sonar, it will take 40 minutes. It's huge. Why? Because you will probably make mistakes, so you have to correct it, then run the test, and so on. So you can change also with your editor, you can use refactoring tool, but you will have to do the refactoring 5 times for each time you have a different duplicated string. So we launch our refactoring engine. So the first step is the reverse. And after, the refactoring engine. And in fact, it's not just launch on the file, but on all the code base. So across the code base, you have 1,600 detected smells that need to be corrected. So then the refactoring is applied. Second iteration of the tool. And by doing the refactoring, we added some duplicated data code smells. So we merge them in a second step. And you can see here, it was extracted successfully. But if you see the change log, in fact, you applied all the change on all the code base. So in just a few minutes, you applied your refactoring on all the code base. So the process was, as a developer, you spot a problem, you think about it, you find a solution, you write it, you configure your refactoring, and then you apply it on all the code base. And in this example, the name is not really meaningful. So after, we have policies that you can configure, for instance, to try to guess a name for the variable, or other policies you can have, for instance, extract only the hard-coded string that are duplicated more than 2 or 3 times with a minimum of 3 characters. And with this kind of refactoring, policies, in fact, is really personalizable for the client. So this example is really easy, but we also have refactoring, for instance, to split huge methods, like more than 300 of lines of code, to extract bits and make new methods. What's interesting, in Java, for instance, in C Sharp, on synchronize the block, always check that you have a static before, and stuff like that. And that's it for me. So. Sure. Yes.
how do you manage quality of your product? I mean, how do you check that all the refactoring are correct all the time?
Yeah, this is a good question.
Repeat the question.
Oh, yes. So how do we ensure the quality of the product over time? So mostly it's used for modernization projects. So it's a one-time project. And after, we don't do the maintenance of the code quality. It could be used, but I think other techniques are more useful because you can rely on the revision between the version. So here, it's more like a snapshot. And we have to save the code base. So after we can help our clients to find good solutions to ensure the quality over time, but mostly it's tooling and also to change their internal process. Mm. Yes. To give example about project, for instance, the C++ to C# example I showed you, it was 600 billions of C++ codes, no unit tests. And it was migrated in 6 months, and it was both our team using the tool and their team to create unit tests, integration tests, and so on. And I think we reached 60% of automation for the translation, and because you can automate. Yes, tedious and monotonous translation task. After, the developer can really focus on what is tricky. So, is it okay, or do you want more example?
So, if I understand correctly, the problem in that case was that you tried to do everything with automation, but that failed.
No, it's just we think that you can't have a click and play tool for that because it's really important to have the human deciding the target, the architecture, and because you have to change some dependency also, you may want to change and recode manually some parts. And also sometimes it's just really difficult, especially for C++. If you have optimization relying on pointers, it might be difficult to automatically migrate it. So for that, we prefer to let the human do. Yes.
A general question on ML on software. Do you find running machine learning on the code base better or code changes get commit? Which one do you have any insights on? Which approach is much better?
Sorry, I'm not sure to get the question.
Now, one approach is running machine learning on the entire
code
base. Or another approach is running machine learning on the commit changes.
Yes.
Do you have any insight like which approach is better?
Yes, what is better between machine learning on a whole code base or based on the revision?
Yes.
I think there is no one better than the other. It's just depending on your use cases. I think over time, it's better to ensure the quality and to improve the quality of a code base. On the old code base, I think it's more for use case, or like for us, or you need to really save the code base, and you don't have a good history and all the change that they will have in the few years, they might not be quality commit because they are just here to. yes, to you have still to have evolution, but because you have a legacy, the quality will be very bad. So you don't want to rely on that.
Okay, we're out of time. So thank you very much.